thank you very much for being with us today. We are very happy to welcome you to our Love Brand Architect virtual panel, building exciting brands by using a leadership mindset, with Mihai Bonca, senior marketing consultant and clinical lecturer, MBA, University of Oxford. A little bit about fantastic speaker's background. Mihai Bonca is senior consultant at Brand Architects. The local and international brands that Mihai has led have repeatedly achieved market leadership, while he received more than 25 industry awards for marketing contributions. He helps boards and CEOs of local internet and multinational organizations redefining strategies, are transforming brands and marketing approach, building roadmaps. In the past, Mihai held board members positions and managed four countries as a group marketing director. When not in the office, with clients or in conferences or with students, Mihai can be spotted on the basketball court. My man, we'll be playing once. By the way, thank you very much for Siva and Panjul for being with us today. You guys have a fantastic court at the University of Luxembourg. On the motivator side, we have our co-host and my dear colleague, Alex Pelican, Head of Partnerships and Ecosystem Development at Loft. Prior to joining Loft, Alex was a Marketing and Strategic Associate at the University of Quebec in Montreal and a serial entrepreneur creating companies in the space of e-commerce and the like. At Loft, he's been traveling the world, connecting fintech entrepreneurs with the local ecosystem, and has been a master of ceremony, interviewing thought leaders from all walks of life. Mihai, Alex, the screens or the court is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Anthony. Oh man, as always, I mean, very complete introduction, but energy to the max. So thank you, Anthony. You really boost everybody on the call. So today we have a very special session, at least for me. First of all, is because I'm doing it with a friend. So thank you, Mihai, for taking the time. And it's a topic that's very close to my heart, and it's strategy and marketing. And we started this session, and we asked Mihai to be on the call today because we saw in our community, most people don't understand what's marketing. We see entrepreneurs that think that marketing is mainly communication and social media. So they make a lot of noise on LinkedIn and Twitter. Entrepreneurship has become what I call a popularity contest today, which is not very good, but that's the way it is. But at the end, they wonder why, I mean, the business is not taking off. Clients are moving. And when we ask them what's your value proposition, and what they tell us, it's because we are cheaper than the others, then we say, okay, we have to do something for them. So we've done something. We've asked Mihai to give 1 hour of his life, which is quite expensive. So thank you, Mihai, for doing it for free. in order to teach our community how to gain competitive advantage, but also to think in a very strategic way about the marketing. So Mihai, time is short, so please, the court is yours, as Anthony said.
Thank you so much for your invitation. First of all, I would like to thank you, Alex and Anthony. By the way, it's my pleasure to be around you. And I consider that this is not a time that I offer. This is a time that I gain from you. And let's make this as interactive as possible. Let's have some fun, because marketing should be fun. Shouldn't be about discounted cash flows and any other stuff that usually happens on webinars.
We might have some accountants on the line, so let's not.
Yeah, I need to be careful. Well, everything is a process. You spoke about popularity contest and cheaper. If the company can offer a significant advantage in the cost over long term, then you have an IKEA. So yes, you can build on long term on a significantly lower cost, but this should be embedded in the company. IKEA is a good example. Toyota is another great example. Volkswagen can be another great example. But you need to embed that in your company. This is not a popularity contest. This is a strategic approach. So this is the single complicated stuff that I'm going to show you. Everything starts from the business strategy. It's about marketing competition assessment. It's about competitive advantages and weaknesses, traps and nice to have, innovation. It's here. Then, after this level, high level of business strategy, we cascade down in the brand strategy. And it's about the brand architecture. And brand architectures always start with the ideology. What is the ideology of the company? What is the company vision? And I'm speaking right now about the operational culture. It's not about the official culture. And you have usually a gap between the two things. The official culture is behind the reception door, painted on the canvas over there. The operating culture is the one that really happens each day and enables people to do their job. And you are going to have always a gap. So it's about vision, the key values inside the company, the operating values, the success KPIs. And you cannot remove KPIs with a values and vision. For example, if you have a brand-faced organization, you should measure that in the KPIs. You shouldn't measure profits. You should measure net promoter scores, for example. And artifacts, like rituals, like what are the company's way to take difficult decisions. These are some artifacts. And then you have the rest of the positioning elements like emotional benefits, rational benefits, and reasons to believe. And you are going to build a design and an experience ecosystem in the end. But everything starts with the ideology. And that's the pinnacle of a brand positioning. After you have the brand positioning, you can think about that. Sorry to cut you, Mihai.
You go very fast. I know we are running out of time, but yeah. Just are you going to come back regarding the ideology, how to build? Okay,
yes.
Sorry.
Yes, of course. That's the entry point. I'm talking fast. You, by the way, English is not my native language. If someone doesn't understand what I'm saying, hold the hand and I'm going to... take one, get the comment. So, and then after I have the positioning of the brand, I need to look to the customer. I wouldn't advise to put the customer first. I would put customer second after the brand ideology. Why? There are two school of thoughts. I know that you worked for Procter & Gamble in your past life. That's the Procter & Gamble school of thought. So I'm listening to the customer and I'm going to provide what customer really needs. Well, that's good. However, for innovation and disruptive innovation, that's not enough. You should understand that the disruptor innovation doesn't come from outside, comes from inside. And you need to push it to the customer. And that's why I'm more careful when I'm speaking to the disruption and the pure innovation to look at the inside, what makes innovation possible, and then to find the right customers outside the company. So I will put first the company and then the customer. And then I unite them in a brand and customer shared ambition. And if you don't have a shared ambition, and I'm insisting on shared ambition, actually you don't have a brand. You have a hobby, you can describe it whatever, but it's not a brand. A brand always bridges the company with the outside world, and that's the brand. It's an artifact of an internal tribe connected with an external tribe. And in the right side, you have everything what's boring, like experiences and communication, Facebook, social media, LinkedIn, Instagram, whatever, it's part of that, but it's not only that, because you need to have a communication big idea. And the role of communication big idea is to take the strategy and put it in, people's language. Red Bull gives you wings. That's a great big idea. Mastercard, priceless. That's a great big idea. Honda, power of dreams. That's a great big idea. So that's the organizing idea of the communication. And then the organizing idea links to different pillars of communication. Social media is one of it, but shouldn't be the single of it. By the way, in case you haven't heard, your Facebook page is not yours. It's Mark Zuckerberg property. You just populate it. You are just allowed to use it in some conditions. So it's not really yours. And your digital strategy shouldn't be social media only. It should be social media among other things. And then you have key touch points, artifacts, brand work, consumer research, and so on. Then you have the commercial execution and the team capabilities. Please do not forget about the team. If you have a brand-faced and customer-faced brand, at the end, the customer is going to come in and interact with your brand. And you need to have a brilliant customer care group. You need to have brilliant service, post-buy service. You need to have very good salespeople. And this is team. This is not social media. This is not LinkedIn. And you cannot replace people that take customer pains and solve them with an algorithm. That's not possible. You need to have people somehow down the road that interact to other humans. It's humans to humans, and technology just enhance this connectivity. So this is the big picture, and I told you this is the single very complicated stuff. I'm going to business strategy right now. What's quite important is to understand that there are three main competitive positions and two positions that really are going to hinder your competitivity. The main competitive position are competitive advantages, competitive weaknesses, and points of parity. These are the single things that you should really focus your mind on inside an organization. Competitive advantage means an offering that I can do inside my company for a need of a customer. And quite important, competition is not up to my offering. That's a competitive advantage. Then I have competitive weakness. Client is interested, competition can offer that. I'm not able to do that. So that's a competitive weakness. And then I have a point of parity. Point of parity means customer is interested, I can offer that, competition can offer that, that's a point of parity. Guess what? Pricing is a point of parity. Unless it's part of my organization capability to offer long-term, significantly lower pricing, and this should be sustainable for both my company and my entire value chain. And then it's a competitive advantage. Who does that? Well, it's IKEA, can be Amazon, can be whatever, companies with huge scale, which from the early beginning, they were built on the idea to offer a competitive advantage in the zone of pricing. The single issue with the pricing is the fact that only one company can conquer the pricing in one market. So it's not a positioning element that could sustain many companies. You are going to have just one. Which is going to be that one? Well, the largest one. And as an entrepreneur that you start a fintech operation, you are going to be on a niche at the beginning. So you don't have scale. So I wouldn't attack the pricing component unless I have a very stable segment that can offer me the weight potential to lower the pricing sustainable across the time. So first of all, who's your customer?
That's one point. Sorry to cut you. I mean, when we see, I mean, most of our fintechs are in B2B business, and them focusing so much on bringing the cheapest product in the market or giving the best price, maybe it's not the best strategy because they don't have the volume. And if you don't have a volume, you cannot focus on a pricing strategy.
And how can I grow if I don't have sustainable income and sustainable profits?
Yeah.
And I would rephrase that and I would ask, which are the underserved customers? Because underserved means that their needs and voids are not fulfilled. So I would search which are, especially in business to business, probably you have 100 customers, all of them. Which are the underserved customers? Let's find the first two of them. Let's find the first three of them. And then I'm going to make a specific and a different offer to these underserved customers, which are a niche. I love niches. And I'm going to have some competitive advantages. And then I'm going to worry how much scalable are these competitive advantages to other clients. But first of all, you need to master a segment, master a niche. Think about Apple. Apple mastered the niche 30 years ago for the guys that were in art direction, directors, like movie directors and so on. They were a very small niche, Apple. 3% niche, that was Apple in terms of computers. And then in time, they managed to gather great people inside the company, innovative ideas. They also had the capital and slowly they managed to go outside their original niche into a mass market. But this was a process of 30 years. In Silicon Valley, in a particular great time when capital was free, almost free, very cheap, and they didn't have that much competition apart Microsoft and IBM and so on. So when I would go to speak with an entrepreneur, I would ask if he found his niche. You cannot go directly towards the mainstream. That should be like suicidal strategy. I should go directly to the mainstream and I would just lower my price. Well, you don't have a private equity behind you. If you have the vision found 100 billion behind you, well, then we change the strategy. But a part of that, you are not going to have the resources. You are not going to have a product that is going to change the marketplace. However, if you find your niche underserved current customers and you can manage to offer significant competitive advantages, well, you are going to have a successful company. What you need to build is competitive advantages. So a brand is built on competitive advantages. And actually, you are not going to have a success based on competitive weakness. So I need to build on competitive advantage and minimize in time competitive weaknesses. That's the whole idea. You cannot win on your competitive weaknesses. You are not going to be as good as your main competition. However, if you put enough energy in your game, you can transform the competitive weaknesses in points of parity, and that's it.
Do you have a specific example in mind?
Let me think. A specific example. I worked in the beer industry. That's a fast moving. We didn't have the best distribution in the marketplace. I mean, you know, fast moving distribution can be a competitive advantage. We had a competitive weakness over there. So in time, we managed to create a good enough distribution platform for our brand. By the way, it was a point of parity. We never excelled. But we had the best marketing department, and that was SAB Miller. If you think about ABI, Anheuser-Busch, InBev, well, their competitive advantage was the financial element and the way they managed to great merger and acquisitions. That was them. And that's why they became number one. So in time, ABI, competitive advantages, helped them become number one. While SAB, because the competitive advantage of marketing was not at the business level as important as merger and acquisition, were becoming number two. And in the end, ABI bought SAB. However, in no moment, SAB could be on the same parity and on the same level with the financial power of ABI and with the way they could market their products inside the trade. So that's an example. If I'm thinking about regular banks, I don't know if ING Bank is an example of Luxembourg. However, in my country, ING Bank 10 years ago or 15 years ago, they decided to be a digital first bank. This is what they did. That was their strategy. So they their competitive advantage was the fact that they put a lot of money into the digital assets, like digital banking, digital devices, mobile app, and so on and so forth. So they had a clear head start. However, their competitive weaknesses was the fact that they were not present in retail. They had very few outlets, like regular bank accounts where you can go physically and talk to someone. And what they did, it was very clever. They said, we are not going to put money in retail. We are going to put money in the digital assets because this is what we believe in. And this is a discussion 15 years ago, not today. So they built an incredible digital ecosystem at that moment. And everybody said, well, we don't know if this is going to be successful or not. So they find a niche. They were mainly business to business. And some managers used internet banking 15 years ago because they didn't have time to go to the retail shop. However, what they did, what can you do with the weakness? Well, you can externalize the weakness. So you can ask someone to take care about your weakness. So they franchised the retail operations. For example, I could go to ING Bank and said, I want to have an ING retail operation in my town, and I'm going to open that on my money. I need to respect the franchise book and so on. So what they did, they played on the competitive advantage, and right now they are number fourth bank into the country and the most profitable one, which is amazing. And they minimize in time competitive weaknesses by asking external partners to come and join in a franchise operation. And they didn't bear any risk over there. If my retail account doesn't work, it's my trouble, not ING Bank's trouble.
Interesting. To respond to your question, in Luxembourg, every bank is digital, by the way.
Yeah, today, but 15 years ago?
We started 20 years ago.
Okay. As a comparison here, probably 15 years ago, a mass market bank probably had 2,000 retail operations. 2,000. And ING had tens. And that's an example. And for me, it's good enough. Now to move further, you need to choose. Either you go on cost leadership, either you go on equity differentiation and specialization. You need to choose. You cannot be in the middle. And cost leadership, because you said about the pricing, it's a great positioning, but only one company can go on cost leadership. You cannot have in the same market two companies. Just one is going to succeed. For example, BIC, IKEA, Renault, whatever, Nokia today. These are the cost leadership guys. And by the way, the business model is low margin, very high volumes. So you need scale. You need scale, efficiency, standardization. By the way, you don't need good marketing people to sell on cheap prices. You don't need even salesmen to sell on good prices. We have the best prices. We don't need salesmen. We don't need marketing people. We just need high efficiency and high standard and high scale. Can you do that as an entrepreneur at the beginning? No. 20 years down the line, maybe, if you want to go there. Otherwise, at the beginning, you cannot have the scale and the efficiency. That's why it's insane. I don't understand why people go on cost leadership when they don't have the scale and they don't have the standardization. As an entrepreneur, you don't have the rules of the game inside the category to understand what needs to be done efficiently and how in order to gain the mass. Then you have the equity and differentiation. And this is completely different game. It's like high margin, low volume. You need reputation, quality, customization. And this is the role of an entrepreneur. If I'm going to one market, which I did in my own category of consultancy, I'm going to open a boutique. I don't want to have 100 people on my floor because I don't know the market yet. I'm going to build it sustainable across time. So I need a point of view inside of an existing market and to create a niche. That's the whole idea. Create your niche. Be your Rolex, don't be your Swatch. Because you can make 1,000 Rolex a year and have a great company, and that's life. However, if you want to be successful on Swatch, you need to sell millions.
Laurent Steve is mentioning that in his, he's smiling, iPhone, you think they are low volumes?
iPhones, no. iPhones are not low volumes. By the way, but iPhones are not the best sold phones right now. Samsung's are. And Samsung, it's a little bit on the quasi leadership. Huawei,
exactly,
maybe.
Because Samsung is less on the differentiation, more on the technical aspect of the, and they have more volume. And
brilliant.
Apple is all about differentiation and
brilliant. Based on specs, Samsung is going to be better than Apple. Better based on specs. Huawei, much better. OnePlus, significantly much better. However, OnePlus is a quasi leadership, for example. Huawei is a quasi leadership. Of course, in the category, in the premium category, or whatever category you want to say. By the way, Android, it's a quasi-leadership. iOS, it's equity differentiation and specialization. Think about, Android is free. If I'm a mobile phone producer, I can access, a rudimentary Android for free, or for a very low cost. iOS, wow, it's mine, as Apple. I mean, they are putting the money on it. They own iOS, they don't own the production of the mobile phone. And this is differentiation. How much market share do they have? Below 20%. However, this 20% translates into 80% of the total profits into the mobile phone industry. Again, Google. And think about that. Android, the Android ecosystem is based on co-leadership. Google is free. I enter on Google, I search Loft, great results, so on. For me, it's free. For you, it's not free. So this is co-leadership. The entire Google company is based on co-leadership. They have huge scale. They offer free products to the customers. So how can I deal with that? In the same time, Apple is based on profit, is based on reputation, is based on customization. iOS, it's a closed environment. So that's why for me, iOS, it's on the right side, while Google and Android and Microsoft and so on, it's on the left side. It's based on co-leadership. A MacBook is significantly more expensive than an Asus computer or whatever other computer, based on the same specs, by the way. So you need to choose. What I would choose at the beginning? Well, definitely on the right side. Find your underserved customers. Then differentiate based on their needs. Have some clear competitive advantages. And then maybe in time, if you are lucky enough and you have enough muscles, you can extend your niche. But the whole idea is to be big fish in a small pond. Find your pond, be a big fish over there. Otherwise, the sharks are going to eat you alive in the open sea. That's as simple as possible. If you don't have your niche, by the way, you don't have your value proposition. I mean, what do you have offer? Low cost? Thank you. I'm not interested in low cost. I need people that offer value, not low cost. Now, so we spoke about the business strategy and how this translates to brand architecture and customer and so on. Then what are the main competitive positions? This is Michael Porter. You need to choose. Either you go on a business model based on low margin, high volumes. Either you go on high margin, low volumes. And now let's go to brands. After you finish the first part, then you need to consider how the brand looks like because the brands are looking differently. Just a pause. People consider that COVID and recession change things a lot, which is untrue. There are some very fixed points to the consumer groups called values and beliefs that don't change that much across time. This is a study in UK based on Ipsos. So if you think 9/11, Facebook launches, 2008 financial crisis, Amazon Alexa, and so on, the differences on some important statements like, I wish I could slow down the pace of my life, are not that much. I mean, this is 3% is within error. So you can consider this, the values and the beliefs of the humans are very, very stable. So the whole idea that the things are right now are not relevant in the traditional marketing, it's just false. Why? Because the values and the beliefs of the people are the same within decades. We didn't have Facebook before and they had the same agreement on some statements. Because brand should be human-centric, not technologically centric. And if you put the human in the middle of your brand, well, the things are, and the rules are going to be the same. The tools are going to change because we evolve. We had a carriage 2,000 years ago. Right now, we have a very fast Tesla. But otherwise, we need to put the humans in the center of our brand. So that's one aspect. Another aspect, COVID changed something. Well, at the values and the belief level, very little. Very little. I mean, this another study, another company, they showed 2020 April, which was the top of the fears related to the COVID, versus 2 years ago, just tiny differences based on tradition and conformity. The rest is almost the same. And by the way, I'm not sure that this is not in the error of research. So the proper values and beliefs do not change. What really changes are the tensions. So you have a very fixed ground, which are the values and the beliefs, and you are going to see them in the ideology part, and these do not change. And you have very volatile ones, which are the tensions. And what happened, and this is Maslow. By the way, Maslow, it's 1943. It's as relevant as possible. By the way, psychology is as relevant in marketing as possible since forever. So let's imagine that I was in esteem mode and or self-actualization, like achieving my potential. However, when COVID arrived, everybody, but absolutely everybody, went to safety and physiological needs. That's why people went to the supermarkets and they hoarded toilet paper and food. What is toilet paper? You find here. What is food? Well, you have here. It's physiological need. And everybody ran, and not in one country, in many countries, many different customer profiles and so on, they run to fulfill their physiological needs and safety needs. What is happening right now, after people managed to mitigate the safety and physiological needs, they went to love and belonging. That's why everyone is going to the seaside, to the mountains, meeting friends, let's go to terraces, and nobody can stay in home anymore. And this is our issue right now. If you look across the continents, across different target groups, different cultures, different whatever, from South America to North America to Europe to whatever, eastern part of western part of Europe. Because these are very volatile. Tensions are very volatile. So on one hand, we have very stable values and beliefs and very volatile tensions. So a brand needs to be built on very stable ground, values and beliefs, and be able to benefit to address volatile tensions. Or maybe, as Coke, they declared, they cannot address safety and physiological needs. So they stopped advertising. This is what Coke did. And that was a very interesting discussion. If you cannot properly offer safety and physiological needs, you are not going to sell anything. By the way, Zoom, if I would put Zoom, it's in this kind of part because I need to connect with people for business reasons. So for me, it's a safety one. That's why Zoom exploded. Amazon offered food, water, and this kind of products. That's why Amazon really boosted his revenues.
Mihai, so, we have a question from, yes. Or maybe it's more point of view from Laurent.
Yep.
He say what you say is maybe true for the B2C point of view, but on the B2B perspective, at least in the media market, there is a drastic rise of technology and media consumption. But to your point is, those media and this technology is just to respond to the two first line, as you mentioned, Zoom, for instance.
Yep. This is security of employment. Zoom is security of employment. By the way, Maslow was in 1943. He didn't know about anything about Zoom. So we use Zoom not because we love it. I would love to meet you in person and drink a beer and chat about. We use Zoom in order to do our business. I didn't hear anyone to say, oh, Zoom, it's amazing. I can't wait to go on Zoom another 12 hours. Zoom drains people. You don't have human contact. That's why it drains people. You don't have human contact. You don't receive the emotional feedback that usually you receive when you have someone in front of you. So Zoom for me, it's safety of employment, of resources. That's everything on Zoom. Wireless right now and internet is also based on safety. It's not yet physiological, but it's on safety. You don't have wireless, you are dead. You cannot work. You are not going to earn your money.
But what's your point with this, with the Maslow pyramid, Mihai? It's, I mean, we have to change, we cannot change the values of our brands, but you can adapt to the way you communicate regarding the aspect.
I have the next slide, which is
okay, go ahead.
The best one. The best slide says that brands are not actually aligned with the customers on the values part. That's why you cannot sell, because your values are not aligned with the values and beliefs of your customers. And that's why you need cost in order to mitigate the differences. So I'm not as good as you perceive me, but by the way, I'm cheap. That's the whole idea. It's like going to the bar and the bartender offers you a drink that you don't want, actually, and you don't like. But by the way, I have a value proposition. It's very cheap. Well, not my cup of tea. However, how the brands are built are based on stimulation, hedonism, power, achievement. While the customers, they really want security, universalism. Universalism means do good, benevolence, do good, be socially involved, and tradition. And people are screaming right now about brands to be socially responsible. And social responsibility is not something in thin air. Social responsibility is part of your brand. You don't have a department doing CSR and brand doing damage. You have a brand doing good to the society. That's the whole idea. That's why people should buy and purchase products to good, do good, a great good, or a net good to the society. That's the whole idea of benevolence and corporate social responsibility. And ESG financing and ESG investment. However, think about who are the guys with hedonist power and achievement. Do you ring a bell? These are the guys in charge of brands. I mean, usually I was a marketing director. By the way, I had power, I had achievement, and I was in a hedonistic part of my life. So usually brands are going to mirror the decision makers, not the customers. And this is native. This is something that we do. Brands are the kids of the entrepreneurs. And in an entrepreneurial world, you have even a higher bias towards this, this way of doing work. In multinational, you still have some rules and regulation and research, mandatory research stuff and so on. However, for an entrepreneur, I'm telling you, the brands are going to overlap significantly with the chief entrepreneur, with the founder of the company. And the brand is going to look like that, while the customers are going to be like that. So maybe this should be the first one to solve, like to align the brand more and to create a shared ambition between the internal company and the outside company.
How do you know? How do you see that there is no alignment? And if you see there is no alignment, how do you solve the problem? And if you could also maybe in a few minutes give some B2B examples, because what the people are asking on the chat is
Okay. The whole idea is the following. I need to jump because we have 37 minutes and we
still have a few minutes before the Q&A.
So let's go to how we build brands because that was the whole idea. And this is not B2B, this is not B2C, it's human to human, and I'm going to show you IBM as an example. So the whole thing mimics, this is a brand ladder combined with a brand pyramid. You can go to university lecturers. This is from 1970, America, Texas. Psychology, this is a tool made by psychologists. Just keep asking why, five whys, this is brand ladder. So this is mimicking how we fall in love and we make friends. By the way, that's the whole idea of marketing. Make friends with customer lifetime value. So the first step, well, how do you make friends? You like that person. This is about brand work. Physical appearance, design artifacts, rituals, five senses. So you see someone, you like that person, design artifacts, like the way it is, that person is dressed, the watch, the car that that person drives, the mobile phone, and so on and so forth. Ritual, saying hello, shaking hands. Five senses, smell, for example, is quite important, especially if you want to have a long-lasting relationship with that person. Personality and vulnerability. This is something that you see at the beginning, the personality of the person in front of you. And there is a narcissistic identification, like, is this person like me and can be a friend? Or is this person significantly different versus me and then can be a foe? This is embedded in our reptilian brain, and we need to be aware of that. And business to business, what's nice in business to business, you are going to meet that person. That's the whole idea. You are going to meet that person in one moment in time or another. Then, should I trust that person? So I met someone, I like that person, should I trust that person? And it's about rational benefits and jobs to be done. But that person can do it for me. And it's about reasons to believe, like show attributes and so on. And heroes and regular members of the tribe. Who is going to guarantee that that person is fine or not? And this is on confidence, but no one would join this meeting unless you, Alex, and Anthony and Loft would tell them, Mihai, it's a great guy. Let's hear what he has to say. However, if you just pause your relationship right now, you have a very transactional relationship. And you cannot win on the long term with transactional relationship because everything is going down to the price. And in marketing, if you go down to the price, you don't have a great brand. So ideally, you need to have enough equity and emotions to ask for a small premium. That's the whole scope of working in marketing. Ask for a premium.
Okay, so can I just jump in, Mihai, quickly? Because, and I guess I'm not the only one that people try to process your way of thinking. This is a lot also on the B2C. I mean, we saw that when I work at P&G, but on the B2B side, you know, when you think about B2B, is more less on emotional and more like tangible stuff, like how much economy your company will make, how much money more the company.
Give me 5 minutes and I'm going to jump in the IBM.
Okay.
IBM, it's business to business, believe me. IBM, okay. It's as business to business as possible. And this is something that I need to tackle. Like business to business is different versus business to consumer. It's not about B2B, B2C, it's human to human. And in business to business, it's much more human to human than in business to consumer. Because in business to consumer, you have media. You put everything inside a can, a beer, washing powder, or whatever. You put on the shelf, so it's very sanitized. Business to consumer is very sanitized. And you have media. You don't communicate directly. You have media. And you work a lot in media, like doing a TV spot, doing a Facebook ad and so on. So it's very sanitized. However, in business to business, you have a direct contact. You don't have media. You don't have a shelf. It's you. It's the company represented by someone at the end of the day. It's the company being called and answering to the phone. It's having a direct interaction with someone. It's client service, it's customer care, it's key account, it's whatever. So you have a direct interaction. You don't have media. It's not sanitized. So it's much more based on emotion and ideology than a business to consumer. But people believe that, well, this is business to consumer shit because here in business to business, we don't do that. So it doesn't exist.
Like, okay, we'll let you finish the presentation and maybe we're going to take some questions and
some feedback from the people. Yeah, at least it's fun. I have one unique problem. It's fun. So I met that person. I like that person. I trust that person. How that person makes me feel? If I go and drink a beer, if I go and drink a coffee, what are the emotional benefits? What are the experience and memories that person is going to create with me? Like this webinar, what is going right now across us? Like, what is the positive connection? What is the emotional aspect of this webinar with our participants? That's everything that is going to matter on the long run. Nobody's going to remember anything that we have discussed, but they are going to remember the feeling of what we have discussed in 6 months. And maybe they are going back to the presentation if something is really popping up. And the last level is the ideology level. The best friends, your partner, by the way, the best friends and so on, they somehow resonate with you. Otherwise, you cannot have a long-lasting relationship. It's impossible. And it's about having a shared ambition. Imagine if your best friend would have a completely different ambition versus your ambition. He's not going to be your friend anymore. He's going to have a decreasing relationship or common values. You cannot have exactly the same values, but needs to be kind of in the same area. That, if they're antagonizing, well, you are going to have long discussions. And this is happening on social media. People have different values, and that's why they enter into the conflict. And the similar way to measure success, having a KPI. And by the way, this is how we build a brand. But we don't build a brand from attractivity up, but from ideology down. So I need to understand what is the ideology of the brand, what is the shared ambition of the brand, what are the clear values inside the organization, like how do we make decisions? What are the products that we launch or not based on our values? And by the way, you know, to spot your value, for example, if you have a 1 million euro project, are you going to jeopardize your value? If the answer is yes, you don't have that value. The values, like in tennis, these are the rules that we need to obey inside the organization in order to create a long-lasting impact to our clients. If you give the ball into the net, it's a net. It's not in the field. It's in a net. That's a value. And a similar way to measure a success. And this needs to work together. You cannot be a client-faced and a brand-led organization if you start to measure success based on revenue, market share, and profits. This is an output. So please measure inputs like customer satisfaction, net promoter score, recommendation, whatever linked to the customer. And yes, at the end, you can also have outputs like, well, what is our profitability? We should also have a higher profitability because we have happier customers. But please measure inputs. Don't measure outputs because that's a mistake. If you ask a salesman to sell, he cannot do anything. However, if you ask a salesman to have distribution, to have visibility inside the store, to have the right pricing, not the lowest pricing, right pricing, to have recommendation, he's going to achieve the sale. So please measure inputs, don't measure outputs, because otherwise you don't know what goes inside the thing. And by the way, on short run, 2 or 3 years, I can sell whatever based on price discounts, making compromising, and so on and so forth. And this is what we receive right now from this output first mentality. I mean, any CEO can achieve a short-term 3 years results by just messing around with their clients and with their products. So after I have the ideology, the question is, how this ideology is going to make people feel? And these are the emotional benefits. And what should I do with my ideology, with these emotions that I want to build to gain confidence? Great. And the first layer, how this is the whole brand is going to look. And it's about brand work, physical appearance, and so on. And then I'm going to map with consumer tensions, and I need to keep account with the cultural canvas, which are the things that I'm going to contradict in fear in order to stand out. Tesla is doing that quite a lot. So what is the cultural canvas of Tesla? Well, the cars are done in this way. Well, we have another idea, which is much better. So this is how a brand is built. Looks technical, by the way, mimics the way people fall in love.
What do you mean? Love and fear is what?
Love and fear. Well, if I go, I need to keep account. So tensions are individual. Why canvas, cultural canvas is collective. If I build a brand in Eastern European part of the countries, this brand is going to be different versus a brand built for Western part of the Europe and different versus Scandinavia. Why? Because people love and fear different things inside these separate cultures. If you want, we can go to the religion level. And I can show you, based on past studies, how religion affects the way how people perceive values around them. For example, freedom. If I take freedom, and I look to freedom in Romania versus Luxembourg, versus Germany, versus Norway, versus Japan, you are going to have a completely different takeout on the word named freedom. If I take, for example, community. A community in the eastern part of Europe is different versus the community feeling in the western part of Europe, or versus Japan, by the way. So you are going to have a different brand if your values are going to be the same.
What you mean by that is we should build a brand the same way we try to attract a spouse or a husband, based on the same values and the same culture.
Yeah, sure. But by the way, culture is beauty is cultural. If you didn't know about that, you have two kinds of beauty. One is biological, which is symmetry. And nobody is completely 100% symmetrical. And that's the biological beauty. And you have the cultural beauty. So if you think how we appreciate the partner's beauty is based on culture. We are here on the Western part of the culture. How a lady should look like, in my opinion, or a partner. So this is a very tricky one. But by the way, think about that. Beauty is cultural. In Japan, beauty is completely different versus Europe and America. In Tahiti and in the island.
Totally agree. Maybe we can speak about that around the beer. As time is running out, and IBM. I still want IBM. To have some people giving IBM. The feedback.
IBM, business to business. Can we agree that IBM is business to business? Yes, it's business to business. Thank you. So in any construction, you need to have a weight. You cannot have everything in the same level. You need to have a weight. It's either ideology, emotional, rational part, or attractivity part. You need to have a weight somewhere. You need to have a gain. You need to have an advantage. IBM has an advantage on ideology and on RTBs because they have long history. So this is how they built. I'm not very sure that this is a thing. Just 1 second. Now it's better. So ambition, build a smarter planet. How? By creation, development, and manufacture of advanced information technologies. This is the ideology. This is the ideology. Their ideology first company. Why? Everybody has technology right now in Silicon Valley. Values, dedication for client success. But this is business to business. And they define that, like build strong, long-lasting client relationships. Wow. Help clients succeed however they measure success. So, wow, but where is technology? Well, technology is down. It's in the benefits part. Innovation that matters. Forward thinking, strive to be first. Love grand challenges and everyday improvements. Take risk and champion sometimes unpopular ideas. It's not about technology. It's about innovation that matters.
Sounds like a generic values. Yes. I mean, everybody yes. could put their own brand on
that. But you need to leave them. That's the issue. You can put whatever, but you need to leave them. You need to have a small gap between the culture that you advertise and the operating culture. That's the whole idea. Trust and responsibility. Tribe member. Very, very successful CIOs choose IBM. You cannot be fired because you choose IBM as a CIO. You cannot be fired, even if the project goes wrong. Emotional benefits. Build a legacy. Become something bigger than just deliver profit. And this is for the clients. If you want to work with us, let's build a legacy inside your company. Wow, interesting. Rational benefits, measurable improvements, RTBs, employees act as ambassadors. Amazing history, and so on and so forth. We also have some issues like, this is, in my opinion, for me, IBM as a brand is very boring, very cold, very old school, especially with the new ones. That's why by the way, I'm quite sure they cannot sell to a Gen Z CIO. I'm quite sure. I bet a case of beer that they are going to have huge issues to sell to a Gen Z CIO, but they still can have some great deals with the X generation. So that's IBM. IBM is 100% business to business. However, what they advertise in terms of the brand, it's about the ideology. It's about why people should choose us and not the others. Perfect. And I will jump to yes. Revolut.
Maybe very, okay. Last one, Revolut. And then we take some questions because we have plenty of them.
Yeah,
thank you.
Last one. So ideology, one app for every payment or money operation. Interesting. Values, resilience, perseverance, and entrepreneurial mindset. Continuous innovation, push employees and technology as far as possible. Leadership style, highly pay setting. This is the company, by the way. I studied, for this session, I studied what the CIO told on YouTube and so on, what they declared in interviews and so on. This is what they told us. And by the way, they have a very high fluctuation in terms of staff. Why? Because they push employees and technology as far as possible. So it's very transparent. For me, Revolut is very transparent why they have high fluctuation. Emotional benefit, hassle-free intuitive application, rational benefits, best exchange rates, especially if you compare with traditional bank. Easiness, you can use phone numbers and phone contacts and bank accounts. I don't need to put the entire IBAN and so on, which IBAN becomes a backend. They do have IBANs, but that's a backend. You are not interested in the IBAN. You are interested that I need to send 10 euros to Alex because he paid the beer yesterday. So that's the whole plot. And a traditional bank never put the client in front. They put the IBAN because that was their system. You know, you understand the ideology. I mean, a traditional bank all the time put, give me the IBAN. Well, I don't know the IBAN. What can we done? I mean, nothing can be done. Well, and everyone said, well, but people don't think in terms of IBANs. People think in terms of phone contacts, mobile phone numbers. I know Alex's name. I have him in my phone book. This is how people behave. So maybe we should start looking at how people behave. And this became a competitive advantage. Simplicity. Send money with 5 touches. I did that. I opened the app, 5 touches, and 10 euros went to Alex to pay for the BS because he paid yesterday.
I didn't receive them yet. I will check.
Double check it. So these five touches, go to your bank account, the regular bank, and try to see how many touches you need to do to your regular bank to send the money. Many of them, like put, insert passwords, do some stuff, double check, write names, write IBANs, and so on. So shadow, they also have a shadow, erratic behavior, cultural issues inside the organization that surface to the exterior. And this matter, this is going to influence my attitude towards Revolut. So this matter, this communicate as well. RTBs, network effects, zero or very low fees, personality, very ambitious, provocative, and restless challenger. Archetype, they do have a clear archetype in terms of communication and brand, outlaw and idealist. That's why they behave the way they behave. And the brand world is very refined, and in terms of user experience and user interface, it's a very refined application.
Yeah, so and it's driven by the founder, the CEO, as Apple was at the beginning, driven by Steve Jobs. Mihai, I know that you have many, many slides left, but we just have 6 minutes left for our webinar. Do you mind if we just give the mic maybe with some people?
Yeah, of course.
Have the feedback, and we also have some questions. So maybe we can start with Laurent very, very fast. Laurent, if you can be very brief, and then we go to Laetitia and the others.
Yes, of course. No problem.
Thank you, Laurent.
Glad to meet you all. This was a nice B2C approach, I think. And I know you are talking about human-to-human relationship, and I perfectly understand that. But the fact is that in B2B world, we are trying to build communities and to get a bigger network, which is really important for us. Because the biggest is your network, the biggest people talk about you and actually makes your business grow. I do not agree with you that social network is just a small part of your business. Today, social network represents more than 70% of our approach. We have built huge communities about...
Where do you look, Laurent, so we also understand the context? Where are you working?
Yeah, I'm working in the media world. I'm working with RTL.
Okay.
We have built... But really, on the B2B perspective, we are BC, we are a subsidiary, technical subsidiary. We are an engineering company, and we work only with the channels, only with technology providers. We don't work in B2C level. But what we have created, for instance, we have created a community called Media and Tech, which gathers about 700,000 people, engineers, talking, exchanging about different topics. And this place our company as experts on the market. And when they want to know what they must do in the next media development, they consult us. And next to that, we are selling our services. And since the trust is already installed with the different people on the market, they know they can trust us. And this is a question of trust. In B2B, there's a lot of trust that comes, and the trust does not appear in your ladder. And I really think confidence it's really important to.
So to your question is where is the trust here in community? Well, everything is about community. I'm sorry, I didn't make the point. So gain confidence is one part. However, what I said, heroes and regular member of the tribes, this is the community, gives trust. So that's gain confidence. However, is not a single element. The most important element of a community is the common ideology. This is my whole point. So we are building communities. That's the whole idea. However, in building a community, trust is one element, but you are not going to be binded to the people that you just trust. You are going to be binded to the people that you also like, and you also feel that they have the same values as you have. This is very human. That's why people gather together. That's why people are friends. That's why people have parties and going together and having fun. Not just because they have confidence in each other, but because they like each other and they sometimes feel that they're in line and they have the same, they resonate with the same ideas. And I'm quite sure, Laurent, that your best customers resonate with your values and your ambition inside the organization. Otherwise, they are not going to be your best customers anymore. So okay. I don't want to downplay the role of confidence. Confidence is quite important. However, to build a community, having a shared ambition is much more important than trusting you. Having the same values is much more important than just trusting you. think about...
Don't you think that having different values makes your company richer?
If the diversity is one of the values, yes.
Mm. Yeah.
So diversity is a value. We share the same value, diversity, yes. The answer is yes. However, this
guys,
is...
Guys, we are really running out of time. Yeah. We connect with you, so we're going to share the slides and also your contact, Mihai.
Laurent, I want to show this. If I do the marketing well, this is what is the end of the road. This is Star Wars. If we do marketing right, this is Star Wars. But you need an enemy. You need artifacts. You need believers. And why rebels... So you are building a tribe of rebels, usually, as an entrepreneur. Revolut is a tribe of rebels. Apple was a tribe of rebels. Nike is a tribe of rebels. Red Bull is a tribe of rebels. Harley Davidson, and so on and so forth. So the whole idea about a community, you need to have an enemy to have a community. Maybe Facebook is an enemy. How? I don't know. Because it's an empire. What are the values of the enemy? Who is the Darth Vader? Who are the artifacts of the competing enemy? Who are the believers? And then I can build my ecosystem of believers, like keep the world free by defeating the empire, use kindness, friendship, self-sacrifice, and wisdom. And by the way, these are my competitive advantages, because the empire cannot have friendship. You can't have friendship in the empire. It's about force. Then the heroes and the myths are building the whole idea of the community, which is use kindness, friendship, and so on. Then you have the right artifacts and you have the right believers. By the way, this is also Miji and Doig in Orange World. This is Laurent and Hardy. So this everything is based on archetypes, on psychological level, and this is how you build communities. And if you think about communities right now on social media, they are highly antagonist. And I can show you another graph, for example, because I didn't have time, the polarization.
Let's go to the last question. And I think we're going to do a session specially on Star Wars.
Yeah, on Star Wars.
No, because if we take this topic about Star Wars, I would say that I would love to enslave the world with my media technology.
Then you become the empire and you are going to have some rebels.
Okay. Thank you, Laurent. But he has followers, so it's good for him.
Yeah, thank you, Laurent.
One last question, because we are already out of time. From Antonetta, I mean, we had so many questions. Andrea, we have Solène who asked us to have a second session. Gucci also has some questions, but let's go to Antonetta as the last question, please.
Yes. Hi, hello, everyone. Thanks so much for the interesting presentation, first of all. So, very quick question. Building on the idea of the cultural canvas you mentioned earlier in the presentation, how would a B2B startup company would position itself, the brand globally? I'm just more interested in the cultural strategy and how would the strategy that you were mentioning explained very well would work across the cultures? Would you apply the same strategy? That would it work the same way?
Well, I don't have a clear answer because I need a segmentation study. By the way, this is one of the way to do it. This is also Ipsos based on 2020 data. So ideally, you should choose some clear values. For example, let's imagine that I go on optimists. These are the technophile people. However, cultural canvas for technophile people are the overwhelmed nostalgic. This is how they interact. So the people that fear the future, populist revolution is over here. So populist revolution would be a cultural canvas for my proposals in pro-globalism and technophilia and trust in medicine. And you can see right now the world between them based on COVID, masks, the guy that want to wear mask and the guy that said this is stupid. Or if I have the radicals, which are the change everything, and I have a very niche product for them. And by the way, Revolut was at the beginning, maybe in terms of naming and so on here. They are going to have a cultural canvas in the opposite part, which is the traditional nationalists, like materialism and achievement, traditional nationalism, traditional gender roles. So you all the time are going to have a cultural canvas by the guys that oppose your ideas. Mm-hmm. And you can build on that. Think about the companies that changed their logo on the LGBTQ issues. Think about the United States companies that change the logo and the communication based on Black Lives Matter. They are going to attack the traditional nationalism in America. Nike was the first to do that 2 years ago, by the way, with their probably the best campaign of the year. And what Nike did was amazing. The Colin Kaepernick campaign, the kneeling campaign. It was 2 years ago. Keep that in mind. So they had the cultural canvas of a highly divided country based on social and racial issues. And they changed their target from traditional white citizens, what they had, to a very gender fluid and to a very, fluid types of racial ethnicity as a target group. And they also had a backlash, like white people started to burn Nike apparel in the States. So this is true. This is something that happened, and we need to keep account of that. By the way, on long run, Nike is going to become highly successful based on this approach. On the short run, the stock price collapsed.
Antonetta, I hope you did answer your question. But I think, given all the questions we cannot answer today and all the comments, quite positive comments, we're going to do, if you have time, Mihai, in a second session, maybe in September, October.
It would be my pleasure.
To dive even more into that aspect.
Yeah, but we need more than 1 hour.
I know, my friend, but time is short for everybody. Mihai, thank you so much for your time and a very interesting session. I will just give the mic to Anthony in 1 second. It's going to be my last webinar before the autumn, before the summer break. So I will just want to say a huge thank you to Anthony, my colleague, for he managed to have more than 40 webinars in 3 months for us and our community. So Anthony, thank you so much. And the mic is yours to close the session.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Alex. It's been a pleasure to serve all of you. Let me just showcase what's happening next week, what we have on the roster. So next week, so first of all, thank you very much for having been with us, all of you. It's been a pleasure welcoming you, Mihai, and all the participants today. We'll keep the virtual panel ball rolling until next Friday, July 17th. On Tuesday, July 14th, we welcome you for our fifth and last international showcase, the blockchain industry in Luxembourg with its key players. On Wednesday, July 17th, we welcome you for the challenges and opportunities in asset management, alternative data, and I with Riza Khoshidi, Global Chief Scientist at AIG and University of Oxford's researcher. And finally, to conclude our sessions, we bring you a fantastic panel to the CEO Roundtable with the CEOs of Société Générale, Bejar, BNP Paribas, State Street, and The Loft on the future of financial services. If you would like to know more about The Loft General activities, please subscribe to our newsletter. And thank you very much for being with us and for having supported us along the way. Back to you, Alex. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you again, Anthony, for everything. Mihai, if you agree, we're going to share some of the slides with the participants today. We're going to set up for sure another date for autumn. Hope we'll have the same people on board. And if you agree to still maybe stay 5 to 10 minutes, because we had so many questions, to stay and respond